Part of the program, the top 40 individual seasons in the National Hockey League. And here's number 40. Tom Barrasso, who was drafted by Buffalo in 1983, became the first goalie to make the jump from high school straight to the NHL. As a 19-year-old rookie, he won 26 games for the Sabres and walked off with both the Calder Trophy as Rookie of the Year and the Vezina Trophy as the top goaltender in the league.
My first year in the league is special because as an 18-year-old American in 1983, it just wasn't generally accepted that you could get into the league and play, never mind get into the league and play as a goaltender.
Tom Barrasso!
I look at the guy who finished second to me that year in the Calder, and it was Steve Yzerman, and I look at, you know, what a great career he's had, and you know, the caliber of players that I came up with is what makes looking back at it even more special for me, is that, you know, it wasn't like it was a lean year. There was a lot of good players.
Another Sabre goalie, Dominik Hasek, holds down spot number 39. In 1993, the Dominator took over in the Buffalo net and began an incredible run of 5 Vezina trophies in just 6 years. That season, he became the first goalie since Bernie Perron 20 years earlier to post a goals against average under 2.
I started the season as a backup goalie for Grant Fuhr, and he got injured, and it was my second season with the Buffalo Sabres, and I became starting goalie, and like 1 month before the end of the season, I had my goals against average was under 2, and the people started talking about it, and it was very nice to finish the season under 2 goals against the average.
At the height of World War II, Boston Bruins center Bill Cowley went on a scoring tear that saw him notch 71 points in just 36 games, a 1.97 points per game average. His run ended with a separated shoulder and knee injury that put him out for the season. Only Wayne Gretzky and Mario Lemieux have topped Cowley's incredible scoring heroics. In 1980, Wayne Gretzky of the Oilers became a sophomore sensation. Just 20 years old, he lit up the league and bested both Bobby Orr's assist record of 102 with 109 and Phil Esposito's season point total of 152 with 164. For his efforts, Wayne captured both the Art Ross Trophy for the scoring leadership and the Hart Trophy as the league's MVP.
When Wayne shot the puck, it was going where he was shooting it. He could always handle the puck better than everyone else. He could always move laterally better than everyone else. He very seldomly fell when he stopped and moved one direction or the other. And his memory was incredible. He knew what was going on all the time.
Number 36, Bobby Orr. By the time the 1973-74 season rolled around, Bobby Orr's career was in overdrive. He recorded 90 assists that year, second only to his record of 102. Plus, he chipped in with 32 goals to finish the season at 122 points as a defenseman. Teammate Phil Esposito won the scoring race with 145 points, putting Bruins 1-2 in scoring and guaranteeing the great Orr another Norris Trophy. On his way to the annual Wayne Gretzky NHL Trophy Harvest in 1986-87, the great one posted awesome numbers. His point total, a dizzying 183, amplifies when you look at the gap between Wayne and the runner-up in the race, his teammate Yari Curry, who was 75 points behind. Another measure of greatness.
Standing on the bench and watching Wayne play night after night, is something you became a spectator sometime. And you didn't know what to expect. It was something original. Practically every night, he would do something different and score a great goal. I can remember when he first started shooting, passing to himself, shoot the puck off the net and get the rebound and do his thing.
Mario Lemieux makes his entrance into the top 40 at number 34 with his glorious 87-88 campaign when he became only the second player in NHL history to average more than 2 points per game. He took both the scoring title and the MVP honors away from Wayne Gretzky, who had owned the Ross and Hart trophies for 7 straight seasons.
Well, it was probably my best season ever. Just coming off the Canada Cup in 87, having won the Canada Cup and scoring the winning goal. Having the experience of practicing for 6 weeks with Gretzky and Messier and Coffey and all these guys that have won cups before gave me a lot of confidence for the season.
In the history of the National Hockey League, only six defensemen have been named regular season most valuable players. The first to achieve the honor was the Edmonton Express, Eddie Shore. In 1932-33, Shore scored a career-high 35 points for Boston, en route to his first of four Hart trophies, which established him as King of the Blue Line in the 1930s. Wayne Gretzky's dominance in the 1980s was evidenced in his incredible 82-83 season, when the Oilers legend racked up 196 points, en route to the Art Ross and Hart trophies. To emphasize the point, his 125 assists alone would have still won the scoring crown. Runner-up Peter Stastny had 124 total points.
If he thought that this was a night that he should have a big night, or the team wasn't playing too well, and he had to show leadership and go on the ice and have a great night that night, you knew it was going to happen, because when he made his mind up to do something, he did it.
Mike Bossy was the 15th overall pick in the 1977 draft, and his impact on the league was purely first rate. In his rookie season, he broke through the magic 50 mark to score 53 goals, the first rookie to reach such heights. His efforts netted him the Calder Trophy and a record that stood for 15 years.
Just sort of the strangest thing about that season was when I negotiated my contract with Bill Torrey. The previous year, I had told him that I would get 50 goals in the NHL, and I think I told him that more out of a negotiating ploy than anything else. Although I did have a lot of confidence in my abilities, you know, who's going to say that he's going to score 50 goals in his first year?
The top 40 was the brainchild of Steve Dryden, editor-in-chief of the Hockey News, who put together a panel of 20 to do the selecting. And Steve, there were...
But, as I said, there comes a time when...
'93, Lord Stanley of Preston started the whole thing, paid $50 for a cup they called the Stanley Cup. In 1899 and in 1900, at the turn of the century 100 years ago, there were the champions, the Montreal Shamrocks. Our countdown to the top 40 individual seasons now continues, and here is number 30. When Boston picked Quebec League star defenseman Ray Bourque eighth in the 1979 draft, they were hoping for good things. They got greatness. In his debut season, Ray set a record for points by a rookie defenseman with 65, and so impressed everyone who watched that he was named Calder Trophy winner and a first-team All-Star.
I remember it very well, and just the whole aspect of a young guy coming in, and the whole feeling of, you know, the NHL, the media, the fans, the buildings, the people you're playing against that you watch for so long. When you're a kid growing up, and some of the players you kind of had for idols, and really quite an experience when you really look back on it. And I cherish those memories forever.
Number 29, the comeback of Gordie Howe. In the playoffs of 1950, Gordie Howe suffered a fractured skull. For a time, his life hung in the balance. But Gordie is tougher than most. He came back the following year, helmet and all, and played in all 70 regular season Red Wing games, and bettered Herb Kane's scoring record by 4 points, raising it to 86. Number 28 in the top 40 goes to the rookie season of Teemu Selänne. In 1992-93, as a Winnipeg Jet, he demolished rookie records. His 132 points knocked Peter Stastny's 109 out of top spot on the points ladder, and his 76 goals wiped Mike Bossy's 53 off the leaderboard. Winnipeg went wild as Teemu took the Calder Trophy and a spot on the first All-Star team.
I remember the feeling, like the Swedish special. I wanted to prove myself that I can play in this league and I can have success. And I couldn't dream about having those numbers, though, but the confidence, it was like a snowball going down the hill. I just wanted more and more and more, and what a year. It was very, very exciting.
The 1968-69 season, Gordie Howe's 23rd as a Red Wing, saw the 100-point plateau reached for the first time in NHL history. That year, Bobby Hull, Phil Esposito, and at 41 years of age, Gordie Howe all go past the century mark in total points. The beat installed Howe in the record books as the oldest player ever to reach that level. Standing at number 26 of the century's top 40 seasons is Brett Hull's goal-scoring tour of 1990-91. His 86 goals for the St. Louis Blues moved him to third all-time in that category, behind only Wayne Gretzky, and stands as the largest margin of victory ever in the goal-scoring race, 35. Brett took home the Hart Trophy as a reward.
The winner is Brett Hull.
That was basically, the Gretzky and Lemieux era, and to be able to come in and take a piece of that and win the Hart Trophy was, at that point, the biggest thrill of my life, besides obviously making it to the NHL and getting a chance to play, to have that dream season and to have Wayne Gretzky, a good friend of mine, sitting in the front row as they called my name for the Hart, and to think about all the great people that have won that award, including my father, Wayne and Mario. It was just a topper of a dream season.
In 1973-74, Bernie Perron came back from a stint in the WHA to post one of the greatest seasons ever by an NHL goaltender. The Flyers won 47 games in front of Bernie to break Terry Sawchuk's record of 44. He also recorded 12 shutouts and a 1.89 goals against average that stood as the only under 2 mark for two decades. Bill Dominic Hasek showed up.
Oh, that was a great year. A great year. Anytime you, you play, I think I played 72 games that year, and you ended up with an average goals against less than 2 goals. It's a good indication of how good the team was, and I think it reflects on the organization too, from Snyder all the way down.
In 24th spot, the Dominator and his remarkable season of 1997-98. He had 13 shutouts, the most by any goalie in the 27 years since Tony Esposito recorded 15. Dominic's efforts netted him the Vezina Trophy plus a second straight Hart Trophy, which makes him the only goaltender ever to win consecutive MVP honors. It was in 1969-70 that Tony Esposito stepped up and delivered those 15 shutouts for the Chicago Blackhawks to earn the nickname Tony O. An amazing performance underscored by the fact that this was his first full NHL campaign, one that saw him win 38 games and capture both the Calder and Vezina trophies.
I played the year before in Montreal, a few games, and got a little taste of it. And then finally, I had my opportunity, and I knew this was my chance. I didn't want to be a career minor leaguer, so I knew I had to give everything, and I hit a right team. I hit a good hockey team with weak goaltending. Perfect scenario. Great hockey players, Makita, Hull, Stapleton, etc. So I knew that I had the right ingredient, and now it was up to me to deliver.
Toward the end of the 1965-66 season, Bobby Hull stood at 50 goals, tied with two of Montreal's finest, Rocket Richard and Boom Boom Geoffrion. Then the Golden Jet broke through and finished his incredible season with 54 goals alone at the top. Along the way, Bobby set a new point standard with 97 and grabbed the Hart Trophy to go along with his Art Ross Award. Number 21, Terry Sawchuk's rookie season of 1950-51. When the Red Wings handed Terry Sawchuk the goaltending job to start the 50-51 season, he rose way past the occasion. The rookie anchored 44 wins for the Wings that year, chipped in with 11 shutouts to lead the league, won the Calder Trophy, and helped the Detroit Red Wings become the first team ever to reach 100 points. Another elite group of 10. Al Strachan joins us right now. And Al, among the elite in that group, some pretty much in the history of the Pittsburgh Penguins, April 23rd, 1997, Mary Lemieux's final game. Broadcasting hockey games, here's the man who got us all started in our careers, Foster Hewitt. Hello, Canada. And wasn't it fitting that he was the man who called the Paul Henderson goal in Moscow in 1972? John Davison standing by via satellite in New York. But before we hear from JD, the countdown continues, and here's number 20. Opening up the top 20 is the 1968-69 season of Phil Esposito, the year the Bruin sniper redefined the concept of scoring points. Phil not only became the first player to reach the 100 plateau, he smashed through the century mark to finish with 126 and take his first scoring title and Art Ross Trophy. Esposito added the MVP award and set an assist record with 77. Number 19 is the Gordie Howe season of 1952-53. By then, Howe, the game's biggest star. That year, he raised his own single-season scoring record to 95 points with 49 goals and 46 assists. He added the Hart Trophy as testament to his value, but the season is best measured by the gap between Howe and scoring runner-up teammate Ted Lindsay, 24 points, a record that stood for 20 years. Wayne Gretzky reappears at number 18 with his 1984-85 season when he recorded the third highest points in the season total of the century, 208. His 135 assists, also a record, matched the total of points runner-up and teammate Yari Curry produced. Wayne won the Hart Trophy that year and, as a career highlight, broke the 1,000-point barrier in the fewest games ever, 424.
The better Wayne got, the better the team got. During that season, everything worked. The team was healthy most of the year. His line mates were healthy. They scored all the time. Yari had a great year that year. The whole team had a great year. And he was part of, you know, he would tell you that he was only part of the team and really never went out with the idea of breaking any kind of records. And I'm sure that he never thought about the records when they were happening. He thought about them after he got them.
Prior to 1966-67, Blackhawks center Stan Mikita chalked up four seasons with 100 or more penalty minutes. But that year, Stan changed his style and became the first triple trophy winner in NHL history. He garnered the Art Ross Trophy as scoring leader, the MVP accolades that go along with the Hart Trophy, plus, with just 12 penalty minutes, the Lady Byng Trophy as the league's most gentlemanly player. Number 16, Mike Bossy's 50 in 50. In 1980-81, the Islanders owned the NHL and Mike Bossy was on a tear, matching Rocket Richard's record of 50 goals in 50 games by scoring twice late in the third period of game number 50. He wound up with 68 goals for the season. Mike Bossy stands in an exclusive trio with Richard and Wayne Gretzky, who did it in 39 games, as the first three players to hit the 50 goals in 50 games mark.
A game against Boston where we finished the game, I think, and lost, and I hadn't scored, and I got called into the little stick room we had in the back, and Bill Torrey calmly says to me, you know, we didn't want to tell you before the game, but we got a death threat before the game on you. And, you know, that was, you know, sort of said to myself at the time, well, you know, you could have told me before, maybe. And I'd said to myself, I wanted to get 50, I got it, and that was it. And the joy lasted, I mean, for about a year until Gretzky got 50 and 39, which made what I went through the year before just look ridiculous, you know. But it was a lot of fun while it lasted.
Joe Malone became a hero as the First World War ground into its last winter of 1917-18. In the very year the NHL was born, Malone thrilled Montreal fans by scoring 44 goals in just 20 games. His 2.20 points per game average is still a record. In 14th place, Wayne Gretzky's 79-80 season, the year the WHA and the NHL merged. Wayne, just 19, was ineligible for Rookie of the Year honors, as were all WHA players, so he became the youngest player to score 50 goals and tied Marcel Dion in the points race with 137. Marcel's 53 goals gave him the Art Ross Trophy, but Wayne captured both the Hart and Lady Byng.
Well, I think the big thing back then with Wayne was that he'd never survived the NHL, and we kind of cruised through preseason pretty well undetected. No, but the games didn't seem to be that much different than the WHA, and I think our first league game was in Chicago, and obviously we were introduced to the NHL that night with the crowd. I think there was three fights in the first 5 minutes, and the games were completely different, but Wayne has always played great. I think he assisted on Kevin Lowe's first goal, and I think he proved to everybody that as tough as that game was, he wasn't going anywhere and was going to be a force to be reckoned with.
In a season when the Bruins won it all, Bobby Orr became the last defenseman of the century to be named the league's most valuable player and given the Hart Trophy. He edged out Ken Dryden in the MVP race by scoring 117 points to place him second overall to teammate Phil Esposito in total points. Orr finished the regular season with 37 goals and a league-best 80 assists. The Montreal Canadiens roared through the final season of the 1920s with 22 shutouts in 44 games, thanks to the goaltending heroics of the diminutive George Hainsworth. Just 5 feet 6 inches, Hainsworth played giant that season, registering a 0.92 goals against average and winning the Vezina Trophy. At number 11, more Orr. It's 1970-71, and Bobby wins the Hart and Norris trophies behind the previously unimaginable feat of becoming the first player and only defenseman to register 100 assists in a single season, territory that only Gretzky and Lemieux have visited since. Number 4 finished the scoring race 76 points in front of his closest blue line rival. As advertised, John Davison joins us via satellite. J.D. standing by in New York. And I know, J.D., a lot of snipers in that particular group of 10. You faced most of them, not Joe Malone. Give you that anyway. You'd like to talk a bit about Espo.
You know, Dick, I played against 6 of those players for quite a few years, so I guess I had a lot to do with some of those scoring records. But, you know, when Phil was first traded to the New York Rangers, I was in awe. Here's Phil Esposito. I was 20 years of age at the time. And then I got to room with him on the road for 7 seasons, and what struck me was what a great competitor Phil Esposito was. He thought about hockey all day long, games, practices, in the hotel, in the room, talking about it. And then the other thing is to practice. We practiced after the team had finished. Phil would work on a shot from the slot, and you couldn't stop it. He wouldn't even look at the net. He had the no-look wrist shot, and shot after shot after shot, and it was hard to stop. He still holds a record for 550 shots in one season. And can you guys imagine playing against Boston and having Orr and Esposito on the same power play? It was awesome.
John will be standing by throughout our program. Speaking of fierce competitors, upcoming a brief look at a memory that I certainly have. The Richard Riot, March 17th, 1955, when the hockey fans in Montreal rioted because their hero had been suspended from the Stanley Cup playoffs. And it hits home to me, the tear gas emptied the forum that night. I got hit by the tear gas right in the face. It's well named. It's gas, and it makes you cry.
Welcome to the Home Depot, kid.
1959, Andy Bathgate of the New York Rangers flipped the backhand toward the face of Jacques Plante. It hit him. Plante was cut. He left and came back with a mask. And I guess you could say the face of goaltending was changed that night. Goaltenders of today owe Jacques Plante certainly a big debt. Okay, we're into the top 10 right now as we continue our look at the top 40 National Hockey League individual seasons. And here's number 10. Kicking off the top 10 is Paul Coffey's remarkable season of 1985-86 when he set a single-season goal mark for defensemen at 48. After erasing Bobby Orr's record of 46 goals, Paul went into the final game of the season, trailing Bobby's points in the season by a defenseman record of 139 by just a single point. He was held scoreless that night, but his fine season earned him the Norris Trophy.
That was just one of those years where just everything fell into place. Ended up getting 48 goals. Had 9 at Christmas time. Didn't really feel I was going to score that many goals that year, but I remember Boxing Day we were playing in Calgary. I think we won 5-4, and I got 4 goals that game, and pretty well from then on. It just, everything fell into place. Everything I seemed to shoot went in the net.
In January of the 1992-93 season, Mario Lemieux was cruising to another Art Ross Trophy as the regular season point leader. Then his world fell apart as he learned that he had Hodgkin's disease. Treatment was immediate and successful. Mario, drained by the ordeal, came back in March, trailing the Sabres' Pat LaFontaine by 12 points. By season's end, he was ahead by 12, collecting 56 points in his last 20 games and redefining the word comeback.
Well, that was a very special year. I was diagnosed with cancer early January. I believe I had to miss 17 games in the middle of the season. and came back early March, right after my last radiation treatment. And I was able to come back and win the Art Ross Trophy for leading scorer, and that's something that I'm very proud of, to have missed that many games and still was able to come back and win the scoring title.
Number 8, Phil Esposito's record-smashing season. It's the season when Esposito defied logic, 1970-71. It took 24 years, from 1945 to 1969, Rocket Richard to Bobby Hull, for the goal-scoring record to rise from 50 to 58 in a season. Then in one fell swoop, Phil Esposito scored 76 in a season, smashing the record by 18 to record the largest increase of the century. The Hockey News' seventh greatest season of the century was provided by Mario Lemieux in 1988-89. He won the Art Ross Trophy that season and missed the 200-point plateau, or Gretzky zone, by just a single point. His 114 assists made him the third member of the 100-plus club, along with Orr and Gretzky. His 13 shorthanded goals stands as a century record.
Well, that was a great season. To score 199 points that season was something special and something that I'm proud of. I had some great players around me that year. Paul Coffey was with us for a couple years at that point. And it was just a great season all around. I had 13 shorthanded goals with most of them breakaways from long passes from Paul Coffey. So it was a great season.
Number 6 on the century list is Wayne Gretzky's 1983-84 season. In the same year he was named captain of the Oilers, Wayne completely rewrote the definition of leading by example. In an Art Ross Trophy season of 205 points, he carved out some history with a 51-game scoring streak, during which he averaged an unprecedented 3 points per game.
John Muckler said it best, you know, a 2 or 3 point night was almost a bad night for Wayne. But not that we ever looked at him and said, well, he's got to get 6 points for us to win. It just so happens that he got 6 points and we were winning hockey games.
The top five leads off with the only full season Bobby Orr ever logged, 1974-75. That year marked just the second and last time a defenseman would win the Art Ross Trophy. By leading the league in scoring, he had 89 assists and 46 goals. The only other blue liner to accomplish the feat, Bobby Orr. He also won his 8th straight and final Norris Trophy as the league's top defenseman to finish off his incredible last hurrah in Boston. During the final months of World War II, Rocket Richard spun a season with so much magic that it carries all the way to number 4. And the drama could not have been higher as the Rocket waited until the 17:54 mark of the third period in the Canadiens' final game of the season, their 50th game, to score his 50th goal. It was a legendary feat that has made Richard's record the standard by which all goal scorers are measured.
And Ron McLean now joins us, and I've got a bit of a march on Ron because I'm the...
Sort of fight it out.
Hockey and Borja Salmi's case right here, not a very pretty face. 86-87, he was cut for 200 stitches. But he had a fine career, became the first European NHLer elected to the Hockey Hall of Fame. We are set now to bring you our final three as far as the top individual seasons go. Don Cherry is standing by, but first, here they are.
The third greatest season of the century belongs to Wayne Gretzky. By 1985-86, it was pretty obvious Wayne was playing a different game than everyone else at a level only he could reach. That season, he ended up with more assists, 163, than anyone else had points. Twice, he had 7 assists in one game. In fact, there were only 3 games all year in which he was shut out. Add in 52 goals, and it rounds off to a 215-point season, the most ever.
Everything happened so quick. I never wondered that I could end up playing with him so many years and so long time, but You know, everything just keep rolling. We had a great time. We were successful. We were winning the cups, you know, and we had just fun. Like, we were like little kids.
The second greatest season of all also goes to the great one, 1981-82, when all he did was score 50 goals before New Year's Eve, 39 games into the season, to be exact. And he got there by lighting it up five times in game number 39 on home ice against the Philadelphia Flyers.
He's moving in. Score! 50 goals in 39 games.
That game, I could have had 8 goals. I had so many chances. Although I got 5 and 1 was in the empty net. I know Pete Peters must have made 4 quality saves on me that game. I could have scored 8 goals that night. That's how many chances I had. So when the 50th went in, I was probably more shocked than anybody in Canada, because I didn't expect it. I told my dad, don't come, that's not going to happen. Wait a couple games.
Then in March, in game number 64 in Buffalo, he knocked Phil Esposito off the high rung when he scored number 77. By the end of that campaign, Wayne had 92 goals. The 120 assists he earned gave him 212 points and a season for the ages.
He got onto a kind of a roll that I used to say when we were on the bench and he'd watch me, you got to double shift Wayne until you get a flush into his face. And as soon as you could see his cheeks sort of get a little illuminated, then you knew the other team was in trouble. And the trick was to get him wound up. And once he did that, you couldn't stop the guy. And you know, a lot of nights he'd miss 2 or 3 breakaways and still score 4 or 5 goals. He was really something that year.
Glenn enforced the theory that we were all one and we were going to win a championship. But he also enforced the theory that he wanted every guy to be the best individual player they could be. He always wanted a guy to win the scoring title. He wanted his goalie to win the best goaltender. He felt that those were important ingredients to making a good team. And so what would happen was that we would be cheering for the other guy beside you. We wanted Yuri Curry to win the best defensive player. And we all felt a part of it if that happened. If I won the scoring title, I know that my teammates all felt that they were responsible for getting me that trophy, and they felt like they were part of it. So we had this chemistry that I guess came because we started together so young. We started at 18 and 19, and we grew up together. And I think that was a big part of it, and I think that was the biggest reason why we were able to stay together so tightly.
The greatest season of all was the masterpiece fashioned by number 4 Bobby Orr in the winter of 1969-70, the year he redesigned hockey. He took home the Norris Trophy, no surprise. He took home the Hart Trophy, again, no surprise. The magic was in his winning of the scoring race and the Art Ross Trophy, a feat previously unimagined by a defenseman. Unimagined until Bobby Orr, that is. He scored 33 goals and added 87 assists for 120 points, all records, and nearly 3 times more points than any defenseman who had ever played the game.
What I remember most about that year was that he dominated in almost every single game. I mean, there wasn't a game went by and then the story wasn't Orr.
3 magnificent seasons, Wayne Gretzky, Bobby Orr, why are we not surprised? I don't think we'll see their likes again. Hockey Night in Canada's Alan Abel now with an insight into number 4, Bobby Orr.
Outskates Burns, over the line. Oh, he's hauled down by Barrett, in for Busek, score! What a play by Busek, and Bobby Orr, who's caught on the ice.
It's been 30 years since Bobby Orr re-engineered Canada's game. He'll be 52 in March. Looking back, he's still grateful for the freedom the Boston Bruins granted him to skate and create.
I was owned by the Boston Bruins when I was 14 years old, and you know, I played a style that, you know, coaches didn't like, teams didn't like, offensive-minded defensemen. And I was owned by the Bruins, and they didn't ask me to change. The guys I played with, I mean, they, in a short time, they knew my style. They knew that if I started, there was a good chance I was going to continue to go into the offensive zone with the puck. And I, many nights, maybe lost it or whatever, and I'm saying, whoa, I better get back there. But, you know, I was always thinking of coming back, but I was, you know, the guys that I played with, they were aware of my style, and it was really funny some nights to watch some of the guys covering for me trying to skate backwards. They were really, really, the forwards couldn't skate backwards that well.
Boston manager Milt Schmidt, the last Bruins player to win it, presented the NHL's highest honor, the Hart Trophy, for the player most valuable to his team.
You've seen them play the way our team has played in the playoffs, and they're just unbelievable the way they're playing, and they've helped me out like you can't believe. I can't thank them enough. And speaking's kind of for the birds.
He's a long-haired guy, isn't he? he was a guy that loved the game. I mean, I had a passion for the game. I couldn't wait to get to the rink. Growing up playing minor hockey in Parry Sound, I loved to go out on the bay, run around the parking lot, shoot pucks in the garage. I mean, I loved the game. I had a great passion for the game. And I think that's also important.
Barely 5 years after his supernova season, Orr's knees were ruined beyond repair. His daring had become his downfall.
If pressure is worrying, I really didn't start feeling pressure until I couldn't play the game like I once did. You know, my leg would not allow me to play like I once did. Then I really started to worry because I just couldn't play my game the way I played, the way I enjoyed playing. And that's when I really started to feel worry and feel the pressure. Would I change anything? I don't think so. I had a blast. I mean, my only regret, I just wish I could have played a little bit longer, but the game has been very, very good to me.
The boy hero from Parry Sound is a player agent in Boston now. He hopes that the liberty his coaches gave him will once again become a part of the 21st century game.
In by Clancy, scores right through the pads of Gordon McRae, and it's 1-1.
Someone commented to me the other day, well, nobody's come along that could skate like you skated. Well, I think there have been a lot of players that have come along that could skate like I at young ages, and they're being told, you know, they're being held back. And for the game, for the good of the game, I think we've got to let our players go.
Here comes Orr up the middle. Over the line, trying to go in. He does! He scores! What a goal! What a hat trick! Bobby Orr is 100 points!
Look at that. Player.
We are joined by a man who once coached the greatest hockey player in the world and who agrees with the committee. They tell me you've got 90 seconds.
90 seconds? I could go all night, and he's pointing to the camera again. Listen, let me tell you something.
I love you all so much. I spent 10 years here in Boston, and they're the 10 best years of my life.
May 10, 1970, as famous a pose as ever was struck in the NHL. Picard with the hook, Bobby Orr from Sanderson, Glenn Hall, one of my personal heroes with the goal, and Don Cherry is separated from Al Strachan. We'll get to in a moment the dispute over the fact that maybe 99 should have beat number 4. But first of all,
he said that.
Yes, yeah. He's going to say that. But yeah. You want to touch on JD and Bobby?
You know, it's funny. John Davison will remember a game in New York, and we beat the Rangers 5-3. And I remember John was just he got 2 goals and 2 assists, and John was just stoning him. And for the winner, he went in, and honest to God, he looked like he said, this is either going in or through you. And John used to have a great big glove, and he hit it so hard. You remember, John, he took the glove and everything right into the net. Remember that one for the winner?
You know, the thing, Don, about Bobby Orr, and obviously you know because you coached him, but his slap shot was an absolute rocket, but it was the short backswing that surprised everybody. He didn't take it all the way up here. He just took it back to his waist and went through it, and it was a rocket. I remember Bobby Orr playing against our hockey club. I was playing for the St. Louis Blues then in St. Louis. You guys, the Bruins were on a penalty kill, and Bobby killed the penalty by himself. He had 2 or 3 Blues, my teammates, chasing him around the net. It was like a dog chasing his tail. This man was an incredible hockey player.
But having said all that, Al Strachan?
Well, Don and I don't disagree very often, but on this one. And the problem with these things is you always seem to be demeaning the other guy. I don't want to do that because Bobby was a great player. But I would question the fact that this season, the one that was number one, 69-70, right after the league went from 6 teams to 12, how many goals did we see on our highlights alone where he was scoring from the blue line? You don't score from the blue line today. You didn't score from the blue line when Gretzky was getting those two great seasons.
You're wrong.
One of them, well, not many.
You know, goal scoring on average was about 5.5 goals, two teams combined per game back around that time.
Which time?
When Bobby Orr scored in 69-70, and when Wayne scored all his points, it was 8 goals.
Yeah,
two
but where
teams
were they from, though? They weren't from way out like that.
Yeah, but
that
doesn't matter.
He was facing
Wicker.
He had
a great shot.
That's because he had a great shot.
Yeah,
he had a great shot.
US well, I don't want to
shoot out there. But he was facing weaker goaltending. The league had just doubled in size.
Well, how much yeah, was there when, how many was in the league when Wayne
This is the
Wayne
greatest
scored?
Season ever for goals, 92. Why is it number two on the list? Here's the greatest season ever for points, 215. It's number three on the list.
Because
they're
Wayne
the best
Gretzky.
Seasons ever.
Go ahead. Wayne Gretzky, I'm sorry, because Bobby Orr changed the way the game was played in 69-70. What he did was,
well,
he did the same thing.
Single season for changing the game. It says single season honor roll.
Historical significance, resonance, dramatic value, and he did for hockey what Babe Ruth did for baseball
yeah,
in 29.
Because,
when he did the home run thing.
Babe Pratt
right.
had 49 points, and he jumped it to 120.
Well, what he right. did was like Babe Ruth went from 29 home runs to 50. Bobby Orr went from 64 points, his own record, to 120. Never been anything like it. It's the same as the baseball. What Wayne Gretzky did in terms of moving the bar, I mean, Bobby Orr replaced the bar. Wayne Gretzky raised the bar. If you consider it, you can compare it to something like what McGuire did with Roger Maris's mark. It's the same sort of thing. Only Gretzky was even more sensational, but it's something of that nature, moving the raising of the bar, as opposed to Orr, who just replaced it.
And
changed the way the game's
hit,
played.
Fought.
And block shots.
And when you talk about expansion, you're thinking dilution of talent, but the fact is, Al, it had been 30 years since they went from six teams. You take the top two teams in the American Hockey League, I bet you they'd have beat the bottom two teams in the NHL. So there was room for that kind of growth. And another thing about that, they played within their conferences. About 66% of the games were played within your conference. So it wasn't like the old teams were running up the scores on the others. And the one point I'd like to make, too, about the 215 points, as much as I love it, Wayne had that, but he had it at a time when everybody was scoring a lot of points. And a guy I'd like to see a lot higher up is Bobby Hull, and maybe Dick, you could speak to Bobby Hull, but here when he scored his 54 goals, and I think you ranked him in the 20 through 25, but the next best was Frank Mihaljevic at 32 goals. To me, that was as dominating a performance by a goal scorer as ever.
But if you're going to talk about that time, though, you might as well demean Phil Esposito, 76 and 76.
Yeah, and another point, you're right,
you can't do that.
Because the most prolific team...
This one here, he has more assists than anybody else has total points.
But Edmonton scored 400 goals 5 years running, and Wayne was a big part of that.
The point is that he is so far ahead of everybody else in the league. He's got more assists than anybody else has total points.
Got to go to break. Are we going to go with Phil Esposito?
The other thing,
there were 10,000 telegrams in Moscow. Hang on there, John. 10,000 telegrams in Moscow. There were 3,000 fans, and the reason they were all there for the Summit Series was because of this speech.
People across Canada, we tried. We did our best. And for the people that blew us, all of us guys are really disheartened, and we're disillusioned, and we're disappointed in some of the people. We cannot believe the bad press we've got, the booing we've gotten in our own building.
Pedigree, there's the great Mr. Hockey, Gordie Howe, with his sons Mark and Marty in Houston. They also went on to play in New England for Harry Neal. And in one game, I was saying earlier tonight on our telecast, at the age of 50, Gordie scored a big goal as they beat a Soviet All-Star team 7-2. He also blocked a couple of shots. Just as we continue here, let's go to John Davidson in New York. JD, you wanted to pick up on where you think a goalie ought to have ranked.
Well, I was just thinking that you're talking about regular seasons here. You're talking about individual players and their efforts. Who has done more than the two seasons that Dominik Hasek put forth for the Buffalo Sabres? I'm talking about the regular seasons, the records that he broke, the MVPs that he won, and he's redefined the position. He's almost like a freak of nature, the way he's able to bend and twist his body, his knees and his back and everything else. And the young kids that are growing up and playing now in that position, they're starting to follow the way that he played the game and his style. I think they're emulating him, and that in itself tells you something.
Good luck if they're trying to emulate his style.
Well, I'm going to talk about goalies. I wonder why George Hainsworth is ranked number 12. Now, that is, if you look at it, off the numbers, a great season, 22 shutouts, 0.92 goals against average. What he had were 43 goals in 44 games. But 52 was by another team, 53 by another team, so it was a very low-scoring era. The leading scorer that year had 32 points. So
who
it's
was
not
that?
Ace Bailey.
There
you
were,
remember
there were also goalies that year had 13 shutouts, 11 shutouts, and all of that. But
so,
Al, you know,
so while it's a great year, should it be number 12 on the all-time list?
That's where it ended up. Hockey started, Al, you know, it was before you saw it on television, you know. I mean, you got to remember about it. I'd like to talk about a couple of seasons that aren't on there. We talk about Mike Bossy with his rookie record, Timo Salani, Nels Stewart back in the mid-20s, led the league in goals as a rookie. It's not there. Mm-hmm. I put it on my list, but it's not there. Bernie Jeffrion, second player to hit 50 goals. That's right. Magnificent season, won the Hart Trophy. It's not there. There's a lot
You know, and there's big changes in the game, Dick. Forward passing wasn't even allowed when your dad was That's second right. in the NHL in scoring to Bill Cook. He finished second, and then Howie Morenz was third. So your dad, as you know, is in the Hall of Fame as a player. They had the red line come along when the rocket was roaring in. They just started flooding the ice in 1940. So that's one of the problems when you try to compare.
And a guy like Doug Harvey, who didn't score a lot of points, would never ever have you could say this is his greatest season. Yeah but he's the second best defenseman of all time, as we hear, and you say, well, he didn't get many points, so he can't pick his one season. He just had all great seasons.
And another guy who redefined the game.
Right.
You know, that's
always
that's
a challenge
interesting.
To do this, though, especially when you're dealing with the older players, as you're relying on numbers. I think the most blatant season that's missing is 66-67. Bobby Orr's first season. And when we ask people to do this, we ask them to look at dramatic resonance, historical significance, and all these types of things. And was there anything more significant than 66-67 in that basis?
By the way, the players called him, and don't get mad at me, the players called him Moses when he first came, and in 3 years they called him God. That's true, that's what they called him, God.
Yeah, it's interesting, Don, you mentioned Doug Harvey. Recently I was talking with Dickie Moore, one of the players and Hall of Famer who was playing on that famous team that won the five Stanley Cups, and I asked him, I said, you know, we all know how great your team was, we know who did what scoring-wise, but who was your leader in the dressing room? Who was the guy that made you guys go when you needed help, when you lost a couple in a row? He said, oh, Doug Harvey. Doug Harvey, by far, was the guy that would stand up in the locker room and talk to the players and get us back on track the way we're supposed to be. And boy, Doug Harvey deserves a lot of credit for the way he played the game.
Don't forget, you can join us on the internet. I want to mention Joe Sakic, 102 points for the Quebec Nordiques when they only had 31 points as a team. I think that's one of the great seasons overlooked. Did anybody else want to jump in with a name or a season?
Steve Shutt. Steve Shutt, left wing Montreal, 60 goals, set the record at the time, later broken by Luc Robitaille, but 60 goals for a left winger, great season.
Guy Lafleur's not on the list.
Guy Lafleur.
Guy Lafleur. Absolutely, you know, electrifying. You talk about a presence. Bobby Hull, for me, is the one I'm most ticked off about. Here's for you, Al. 81-82, the Oilers were scoring 5.6 goals a game. The league average was 3.9, so they were 44% better. The best explosive team in the NHL history, 70-71 Bruins. They were scoring 5.1 a game when everyone else was scoring 2.1. So they were 72% better. That's how good Bobby Orr was. Anyhow,
Ronnie, just one more thing.
I'm not denying really quick, Bobby really Orr was all a great player.
Check everybody's record after Bobby Orr retired. All the guys that play, see how many goals they got after he retired.
And remember 1976 when Red Army played Philadelphia. That's Van Impe coming at Harlamov. And as a result, this is Bob Cole.
They are leaving the ice.
They're going to go.
The Soviets are leaving. They're going home. They're going home. Yeah, they're going home. Can you imagine?
Of the early 1980s, the New York Islanders, Dennis Potvin won the Calder Trophy. He was a Norris Trophy winner on three occasions, inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame in 91, but he made one mistake, Don. He said he should have been the MVP of the 76 Canada Cup.
I know I don't have much time, but let me tell you, Dennis Potvin was one of the meanest guys that ever played the game. Believe me when I tell
you. And one of the best. There's no doubt about
absolutely.
That. Okay. We're going to shift our focus to the All-Stars of the Century, as selected by our Hockey Night in Canada colleagues and editor-in-chief of the Hockey News, Steve Dryden. We'll look at the top six players and then the second team All-Stars, but we're going to begin with coach and general manager. And Don, you'll love that, as a Jack Adams Trophy winner who said there'll be a lot of deserving coaches win this, but none more deserving than me.
That's right.
The general manager job on this All-Star team goes to Slats. Glenn Sather arrived in the NHL in 1966 as a rookie with the Boston Bruins. 10 years and five teams later, his career as a player in the league ended. Soon after, his career as one of the game's great architects began. He has spent 24 years in the Edmonton Oilers organization. The year Edmonton became an NHL city, Glenn became coach and vice president of operations. What he fashioned next, quite simply, led to the evolution of hockey and put his signature all over the last true dynasty of the century.
The personal satisfaction that I like to see that happens in a team is the team becomes a team. They play for each other. And the next thing is when a player goes from being a young junior player that you see at training camp and turns into a man and becomes a player in the NHL as a regular player. Somebody like Ryan Smith, to me, I've been happy to see the evolution in his life so far. But all those young guys that came here, you know, they all have a special part in my life, and I appreciate what they did, but I probably enjoyed watching them grow up more than anything.
The overwhelming selection as coach of the All-Century All-Stars is Scotty Bowman, who first stepped behind the bench of an NHL team in 1967 in St. Louis. He's been in hockey's trenches ever since. Between that season and this, he has won more regular season games and more playoff games than any other NHL coach and is tied with Toe Blake at 8 Stanley Cups. He's the first member of that fraternity to bring the championship to 3 different franchises.
Well, it's changed so much. The coaching, when I first started, it wasn't as sophisticated. You didn't know very much about the opposition. You knew what you could find out. Now there are very few secrets. There's so much available to, there's so much technological support and help that a coach gets. So you're kind of like, I guess, steering the ship along, but there's so many other people that are so important. You're keeping your players in top condition. I mean, you have every, facet covered, goaltender consultants or coaches and psychologists and your training staff. So it's a much more complex job now.
The trophy goes annually to the top goaltender in the NHL, of course, for George Vezina, whose last game, yeah?
I like naming it after guys like that. Should be the Bobby Orr trophy. Should be the whoever wins the scoring. It's Gretzky trophy. Whoever heard of Jennings and Norris
used to
and
be
guys
owners,
like that? It's
directors,
absolutely
people
ridiculous.
Of influence.
So what?
Gretzky should be the MVP. The Hart should be renamed the Gretzky. The Art Ross should be named the Gordie Howe, and the Norris should be the Bobby Orr.
Absolutely.
There goes tradition. There goes tradition. Oh, he doesn't
tradition.
Do a good enough job.
For
of
the moment, fellas, we're going to focus on the 12 best players, the first and second team All-Stars. In the tradition of George Vezina, the Chicoutimi Cucumber, let's look at who Hockey Night in Canada and Steve Dryden and the Hockey News crew feel are the best of our time. He is still the all-time leader in career wins, among the very best that ever played the game.
For 21 years, until his untimely death in 1970, Terry Sawchuk stood them on their ears. His 103 career shutouts is a record that will stand the test of time. And his image shines brightest from that golden era of great goaltenders. Sawchuk posted a remarkable 2.52 lifetime goals against average in 971 regular season games, and he anchored 4 Stanley Cup championship teams. That puts him in sweater number 1 on the All-Century All-Star team.
Hey, Bobby Orr, when he played for me, 46 goals, 89 assists, plus 128, the greatest hockey player who ever lived and whoever will live. Believe it.
Hockey can be divided into 2 periods, before Bobby and after Bobby. Number 4 didn't just play the game, he changed it and became an inspiration. He accomplished so much in just 12 years that our expectations of what hockey could be were raised. For the record, he scored 270 goals and 645 assists in just 657 regular season games. On defense, Bobby Orr is the all-time king.
All the records Bobby Orr broke were set by Doug Harvey. He was a true master of the blue line.
Doug Harvey played on 6 Stanley Cup champions during his incredible 20-year NHL career. Beginning in 1947, he logged 1,113 regular season and 137 playoff games. Before Bobby Orr, Doug was the NHL standard for defensemen, and he made an impact so great that more than 30 years after his retirement, he is still honored with a place on the blue line of this All-Century A-Team.
All you have to do is check the record book, which he rewrote, to know that Wayne Gretzky is the greatest center of all time. And a century from now, when they do this again, most of those records will probably be intact, and he'll still be regarded as the greatest center in hockey history.
Since Wayne Gretzky's retirement last season, his 20th in the NHL, there has been a constant flow of accolades and admiration, all of it earned 10 times over. Wayne, quite simply, elevated everything and everyone around him. He scored more goals, more assists, totaled more points, and did it faster than anyone else ever. In all, Wayne Gretzky holds or shares 61 NHL records, in and of itself a record. By any measure, he centers the first line on this all-star team.
Imagine playing in the National Hockey League at the age of 52. Without a doubt, there has never been a better right winger than Gordie Howe.
To earn a nickname like Mr. Hockey, you have to make them believe. Gordie Howe did just that for 26 seasons in the NHL, a career that started in 1946 as a Detroit Red Wing and ended in 1980 in Hartford, 1,767 regular season and 157 playoff games later. No man who ever suited up had more heart or played harder than the all-century starting right winger, Gordie Howe.
When this guy picked up the puck on the rush, the temperature of the opposing goalie went up 30 degrees. He turned hockey into a power game.
He blew in off the Bay of Quinte in 1958 with such force that over 30 years later, he still stands as the century's definitive left winger. Bobby Hull was a goal scorer through and through and became the prototype for generations of big shooters. The Golden Jet was hockey's first million-dollar man. He played in 16 NHL seasons and scored 610 regular season goals plus 67 in the playoffs. Bobby Hull, first line, all-century all-star. Leading off the second team is goaltender Patrick Roy, who came up as a rookie with the Montreal Canadiens in 1985-86 to win 23 games and 47 regular season appearances. Then, with a playoff goals against average of 1.52, he won the Conn Smythe Trophy. His four Jennings and three Vezina trophies helped Patrick Roy earn his place as a second-team all-century all-star. Dennis Potvin patrolled the New York Islanders' blue line for 15 years, leading the team to four straight Stanley Cups. One of the game's hardest hitters, Dennis won the Rookie of the Year honors in 1974, then added three Norris trophies to his impressive list of career accomplishments. Paul Coffey moves on to the second team All-Century All-Stars on the strength of his incredible offensive skills. Coffey stands seventh at all-time scoring, is second only to Wayne Gretzky in career assists, and second only to Mark Messier on the active players list. Paul has also won three Norris trophies. Centering the second team is Mario Lemieux, who, like Bobby Orr, had just 12 seasons in which to shine. In that time, though, Mario was purely magnificent, averaging over 2 points per each of his 745 regular season games. Also, like Orr, Mario was forced into early retirement, leaving us to wonder what might have been. The second-team right-winger, Maurice Rocket Richard, is a lifetime Montreal Canadian who took passion and fierce determination into every game he played throughout his entire 18-year career. The Rocket played on 8 Stanley Cup-winning teams, scored 544 regular season goals, and added another 82 in the playoff wars. In 1958, the Calder Trophy was won by Toronto rookie Frank Mahovlich, who edged out Bobby Hull for the honors. Thus, in 1 year, the century's two preeminent left-wingers arrived in the NHL. Frank became known as the Big M and played on 6 Stanley Cup championship teams in 18 NHL seasons. One of these special team slots goes to Bob Gainey as a penalty killer. The man that the brain trust of the mighty Soviet hockey empire once called the best overall hockey player in the world. In 16 outstanding seasons, all with the Montreal Canadiens, Bob took part in 5 Stanley Cup celebrations. The second penalty killer is Yari Kurri, who came to the NHL in 1980 as an Edmonton Oiler and became a true pioneer for European players. 18 years and 5 Stanley Cups later, the fabulous Finn retired, after averaging better than a point a game throughout his career. John Ferguson played in only 8 NHL campaigns, but his team, the Montreal Canadiens, won 5 Stanley Cups during his tenure. A team policeman and leader who could play any style of game, John Ferguson suits up as the enforcer and an all-century all-star.
So there you have the...
When Bill Masterton of the Minnesota North Stars struck his head on the ice and succumbed to his injuries. Each year, the player exhibiting perseverance is awarded the Masterton Trophy. And who will forget Paul Henderson?
In 1976, the first Canada Cup tournament featured an outstanding Canadian team. The competition further elevated international hockey in the minds of fans who saw Canada win it all, beating Czechoslovakia in the final game behind Darryl Sittler's overtime winner. As fate would have it, the tournament became the stage where Bobby Orr played out his final big scenes, and he was named the most valuable player. In 1952, the Detroit Red Wings amassed 100 points and lost just 14 games en route to the league championship and the Stanley Cup playoffs. They wouldn't lose again and swept the championship in 8 straight games. The star of the show was Terry Sawchuk, who did not allow a single goal to be scored on Detroit ice in 4 home games. In 1951, Bill Barilko was emerging as one of the NHL's top defensemen. That spring, he became a legend in Game 5 of a Stanley Cup final between the Leafs and the Canadiens. Toronto was at home. They were up 3-1, all 4 previous games having been settled in overtime. Then, Bill Barilko scored the biggest Toronto goal of the century at 2:53 of the first overtime period in Game 5, and the Leafs won the Stanley Cup.
To the side, he passed right out to Barilko's on the left wing. He should have scored!
Tragically, Barilko died in a plane crash just weeks later. 3 years after the Summit Series, the National Hockey League and the Soviet Hockey Union agreed to a series featuring the Soviet Red Army and the Wings of the Soviet against NHL teams. On New Year's Eve, the Red Army team with Valery Harlamov and Vladislav Tretiak skated onto the Forum ice for a date with Montreal that became one of the benchmark games of the century. In 1942, the Toronto Maple Leafs were expected to beat the Detroit Red Wings and win their first Stanley Cup in a decade. But the wheels came off early in the series, and the Leafs found themselves down 3-0 and down 2-0 in the first period of Game 4 in Detroit. Then the comeback of the century began when goaltender Turk Broda stepped up and led the Maple Leafs to the most remarkable rally in the history of professional sports. In the spring of 1984, the New York Islanders were set to enter the exclusive 5-in-a-row club when they ran into a team of buzzsaws from Edmonton. The Oilers won their first Stanley Cup, and a Canadian city came of age.
Folks, there's a new bunch on the block in the National Hockey League, the Edmonton Oilers.
Throughout the entire century, only one team captured the Stanley Cup 5 straight times. From 1956 until 1960, the Montreal Canadiens were the kings of hockey.
We'll come back with the top 3. Earlier tonight, Boyd Devereaux scored a goal and an assist. There's a famous shot of Ace Bailey and Eddie Shore. Eddie Shore had swung his stick over Ace's head, broke his skull, ended his career. They had a benefit game, which really, in effect, was the first ever All-Star game.
No, he didn't. He flipped his feet out from under him,
and
he fell back
and
hit his head.
Well, come on.
That's true.
Get ready.
Maybe I was thinking of Guy Talbot on Scotty Bowman.
That's right. That's okay.
John Guy Talbot.
They sound, the names sound the same.
That's true.
Yes.
Or maybe I said Dick. Oh, never mind. All right, let's go to the top 3 headlines as selected by you at cbc.ca.
In the history of Olympic hockey, the United States has won gold twice. First in Squaw Valley, California in 1960 when they pulled off an upset.
2-1, and the game is over. The United States wins.
men again on home turf in Lake Placid, New York in 1980 when they pulled off a miracle.
11 seconds. You've got 10 seconds. The countdown going on right now. Morrow up to Schultz. 5 seconds left in the game. Over. You believe in miracles? Yes! Unbelievable.
The 1987 Canada Cup was the greatest tournament ever. Canada battled through the round robin, past a tough Czech squad in the semis, and into the best of three final against a tremendous Soviet team. Game one was at the Montreal Forum. 6-5, Soviets in overtime.
Into center ice. To Lomachen. Samyanov, the same hockey scores!
Game two was played in Hamilton's Cops Coliseum. 6-5 in double overtime for Canada.
Up to Murphy. Murphy to Gretzky. Hit the post. Rebound. They score! Mario Lemieux!
Game three, also in Hamilton. The score as the clock wound down, 5-5.
Lemieux ahead to Gretzky. As Murphy with him on a 2-on-1 to Lemieux. And a goal. He shoots. He scores!
The top headline of the century is a gimme. The banner for an oft-told tale.
Dadron shot it in back of the goal. Dadron shot it in back of the goal. That was a close call there. As Dadron had his shot.
Still first period of the Moscow debut. A study in ferocious attack. Ferocious Canadian attack. But Tretiak was first to break. Turnaround. Now they looked overconfident, and we were underdogs, fighting back. Canadians, 3,500 strong, they became a factor in stark contrast to the impassive Moscow bureaucrats who gobbled up the Luzhniki tickets. 9 minutes later, Paul Henderson's star in ascent, he made it 3-0. The thrown together line of Henderson, Clark, and Ellis hit stride. Then, in a moment, it was nearly pulled apart.
The defenseman tripped me, and it spun me around, and I was going at full tilt, and I knew I was going to go into the boards. I was out cold. Joe Scrow, the trainer, told me, came out and he broke three of the ammonia packs under my nose even before I came around. And I was totally out of it.
The crowd was gripped in shocked silence, felt most strongly by Paul's wife, Eleanor.
My immediate reaction probably was fear, for fear it was a serious injury of the neck or the brain, and them not having the facilities here that we were certainly used to. Our standards of medicine would not be up to par here.
Henderson summoned courage as the game went on. By the intermission, he'd made up his mind.
You know, I was crying. I said, Harry, you've got to let me play. And so he looked at the doctor, and the doctor says, well, you know, he says, I can't stop this, but he says, I'm telling you, you probably should not play. You know, you got a slight concussion. And I said, well, you know, let's go. And so Harry said, okay. And so we went back out.
Paul Henderson has returned to the ice for the first time after his injury when he went in the fourth.
By the time Henderson returned, Blinov had narrowed the score to 3-1. And then
Clark makes a long pass to Henderson. He's in the clear. Right in the goal. He scores! Henderson! Ron Clark, beautiful.
Finally, breathing room. A three-goal third-period lead. Then, inexplicably, he stopped skating, and they pounced.
Kakashev again took it off the board, centered it along the side. And it was Hamilton. Another scoring play, and right in now, the first front. The Soviets keep rushing in, and that was scored by Blue Line. There's a long shot. He fires!
It seemed that it was just not meant to be. After all, we'd come so far, played so well, and therein lay the hope.
Personally, I felt the turning point of the series was Game 5. I'd watched the game carefully, and I went in, and I was telling the players on the team, boys, I said, we can beat this team. That was the first time that I saw on the ice that we could beat that team.
4 goals in 5 minutes. Devastating. It would have been easy to fold right then, right there. There'd be no more goals for Canada. The score remained 5-4 Soviets. Understandably, frustration prevailed. But this would pass. Defeat was simply unacceptable to this team.
Probably the best thing that happened was when they won that game, they won the series, and they started to think, we have got it now. And all of a sudden, we got into the corner like cornered rats. So emotionally, in their psyche, that may have been the best thing that happened to us to lose that game.
3,500 rose in unison and cheered our exit. The Russians thought we were beaten, but arrogant pride cuts both ways. Hot September in Moscow. The Soviets forgot the lessons of Montreal. It showed in their walk and on the ice. This time, we were the ones practicing. Backed as far into the corner as it's possible to get. And they were the ones watching, smiling confidently, certain of victory. The only real concern came from Tretiak and deposed coach Anatoly Tarasov. Moscow was full of hockey talk and puzzled by the behavior of the boisterous Canadian fans.
I still am convinced that if we'd been there without fan support, we will never know, but we would have had a tough time winning any games.
The Canadian fans were few in number, but they managed to out-cheer our fans. We had never experienced anything like that at home. I felt like I was playing in Canada instead of Moscow. Unlikely, but that's how it was.
But the fans were outstanding, and the telegrams that we receive, and I think we received one with 10,000 names on one telegram.
When you'd walk outside, the dressing room, and you'd find telegrams or barrels and barrels of postcards.
And the Russian guards over there wondering what the heck we were doing, pasting up all these names throughout our dressing room and down the hall. It was fantastic.
And you could almost see our players, anytime they got down and depressed, you can almost see them glancing at the fans, and they found them quickly.
Ken Dryden at last showed true form, a rock in a sea of emotion.
When you're in the midst of something like this, it's up to those people who are kind of setting the tone of things to offer a bit of a counterbalance. Because what can happen otherwise is that people can go over the edge. You listen to the voices of people 20 years later talking about, this kind of series. The passion is still there. Imagine what it was like then.
The refs, Bader and Kampala, were terrible. We'd get 31 minutes in penalties to their 4. Tempers teetered on the brink. The first period passed with no score, but early in the second, the Soviets broke through. Then we struck. 3 goals in 1.5 minutes.
Defenseman. Another chance for Gilbert. A shot by not. Another one. It's scored! Here it is. Tied it up. Blocked by Hugh Staple and getting it away. Back to the net. Barrett. It's scored! Kamaye. Off the goal. Tenders jumped in. Three of the Nam starters.
Now then, Canada coming up. It's good to go!
They got one more, but Henderson's would be the winner. What came next, though, was a piece of infamy. Clark and Kharlamov. Watch the stick.
Fever, this game is reaching a fever pitch, and they're really hitting each other hard. Tempers are flaring.
John Ferguson was a tough player. As a coach, he had a tough code.
Kharlamov had incredible skills. He was hurting us all the time, and I called Bobby Clark over to the bench, and I asked Bobby, I said, Bobby, try to tap that ankle of his and break it, and we'll slow him down.
He'd give me a pretty good jab with his stick, and I turned around, and I knew who it was, and the puck started going the other way, and I chased him down, and I just give him a whack across the side of the ankle, and I don't know if it broke his ankle or not. He wasn't an effective player. He tried to play after that and wasn't very good.
The game reached a boiling point. Kampala and Bader, unfamiliar with the Canadian game, only made it worse. Their version of taking control translated into a steady procession of bodies to our penalty box.
The Canadians keep going. Here's a penalty for slashing, and Dennis Powell is going to get the goal.
At times, the game turned vicious. Team Canada was stocked with players used to grueling Stanley Cup series, but the referees and the Soviets were in uncharted territory. The Moscow fans were completely disapproving of the physical Canadian game and voiced their objections loudly.
Sitting there watching your teammate sit on the ice with 2 minutes and 21 seconds to go, knowing that you only have a one-goal lead. This is really the hardest spot game I think I've seen in years. Foster, I can't believe it. Down in that ice, it's just sheer war. These two teams are going at it. They're not sparing the lumber. They're not sparing the body. But is it tough down there in the ice? And Team Canada are giving by far, I feel, the best effort so far in this whole series.
We are very emotional type of player. Everything that we do is emotion. And that's the one thing that really kind of give us a little advantage. And we were able to make them feel a little less confident because of the way we played. And, well, we won because of emotion.
3-2, our first win since Toronto. But that was long ago, at a time when it was still just a game.
It's not a game. I just can't help it. That's the way I feel. It's not a game. It wasn't a game. It wasn't a series. It was our society against their society.
In those days, the Soviet Union was the big, bad Russian bear, the home of communism, the enemy of democracy.
Well, at the time, there was absolutely no question that it was a battle of lifestyles or beliefs.
It was like the communist country winning over us. Communist country sending the world a message that our system is better than yours.
The grim faces of Luzhniki, Game 7. Nothing mattered now save victory. Our food had gone missing, no matter. Surveillance wires in our hotel rooms, no matter. Late night phone calls, no matter. All that counted would unfold here, and hockey, our game, was forever changing in front of our very eyes. Period one. It was beyond the war on ice. It was pure survival.
And the puck goes into the corner. They're trying to get into position there. Henderson into Ellis in the corner. A pass right in front of him. Zito scores! Esposito on Ellis. And there's Canada drawing first blood. Esposito. Canada was about about to make a change. Play goes right on. The action cam coming down the path. Here they go.
Each successive game redefined intensity, and always at the center, Phil Esposito.
Phil Esposito is saying plenty to the Soviet player who waved him away. And was Mihailov.
In this game, neither side would let down.
He gets that shot right in that goal right there. He gets the score. Went right in to score. Drawing the goalkeeper out. It's back to Savard. He fakes the shot, turns. There's going to be a penalty call here. Esposito shoots. He scores! Esposito fires that puck and it's all tied up again.
All tied up again. Now each shift was critical to success. Here, in the seventh game of a long, hard series, neither team was dominant. And as it happens, the adversaries knew each other well, perhaps much too well. The second period settled nothing. The score was still 2-2. There were 20 minutes left to play. Time was winding down, and both teams knew that if Canada was to take the series, they had to win tonight. Then, with 3.5 minutes left, everything exploded. Mikhailov, arms pinned, committed the unpardonable and kicked out, first at Gary Bergman. Bergman, hole kicked through his shin pad, leg bloodied, circled the pack, stalking Mikhailov.
Emotion prevailed over common sense at that moment and after that. You know, I have never felt good about it. And if he is watching this interview, I would like to say that I am sorry. I never meant to hurt him, and I did not act as a professional. I acted as an amateur.
The act cost the Soviet team dearly. Their leader took himself out of the game at the most crucial time. In the dying moments, high emotion had exacted its toll.
Some of the guys had real difficulty controlling their emotions, and I think some of them after that series were never the same.
2 minutes left. Cue Paul Henderson.
Tried to make a little move and lost the puck off the guy's skate. He came over, kicked it in behind, and I felt myself going down, and I looked up, and there was only one place to put it, and that was right under the bar. And boy, went under the bar, and I'll tell you, one of the greatest feelings. And you know, when I watched the replay today, I mean, if there's any one goal that I could sit there and watch for 2 hours, it's that goal I scored in the seventh game.
Two must-win games, and for Henderson, two game winners. Moscow's wintry streets, they learned to love the game as we do. So it was for Tretyak the boy, and later, on the fields at Arkhangelskoye, for Tretyak the young man. So it was in 72.
I think that we all learned from each other. And we in Soviet hockey learned a lot from Canadians. Canadian players have great talent and battle to the end.
Curtain call in the Soviet Union. the dirtiest trick of all saved for Game 8. The sounds of O Canada filled the Luzhniki Ice Hall. Angst and anger filled our hearts. Uwe Dahlberg, our choice of referees, was forced out by Soviet officials. They needed victory that badly. Al Eagleson carried the fight right to game time.
I knew it was going to be impossible in those circumstances to get Dahlberg, but I thought we might as well let our team know that they were trying to cheat us again.
The Soviets reinstated Kampala, game six incompetent, in spite of the Canadian protest led by Eagleson. 100 million people in two countries paused, ready for hockey's most important game.
We finally settled on two referees, Bada and Kampala, and went into the eighth game with hope and fear and all the other things that proved out to be justified.
The air in the Moscow arena here is tense as we get ready for this eighth and final game of the series. So if you've been writing the script, it couldn't have produced a more dramatic and exciting final. Tonight we are making hockey history.
It only took 2 minutes of play for Eagleson's fears to be realized. The referees would be a factor. Canada would fall victim to Kampala's outrageous calls. First, Bill White. Then Peter Mahovlich. Strange calls had everyone confused and edgy, even the Soviet team. 46 seconds later, with Peter Mahovlich still in the box, Kampala whistled down J.P. Parise. The two-minute minor was only the beginning.
I give him 2 minutes penalty for elbowing. Parise say to me, "You bloody German referee." I say, "Okay, I give you 2 minutes more."
The Russian tactic was working. All Canada was infuriated. Our team in apparent disarray.
They out and out cheated in that particular aspect of the game. That was not the way the thing was planned. It was not the way it was agreed to.
A misconduct call later, and rage consumed Jean-Paul.
Maybe sometimes you don't understand who you are. Never would I have realized that I would have become such an enraged man for 2 weeks.
Original penalty, interference was the first call.
Parise was thrown out. The fans chanted, "Let's go home." On the bench, Harry ripped into the Soviet officials who'd taken part in the referee switch.
We just erupted, players and the coaches and everybody. We lost it for a while. But that's not all bad.
For the moment, it sparked the team. In spite of it all, the series was deadlocked again. On the ice, the struggle ensued, despite injury, injustice, and that constant stream of penalties. The second period, a strange bounce. The netting around the ice helped catapult them into the lead.
Into the Soviet zone, Vasiliev cleared in front of his own net. It's grabbed off by Henderson momentarily. Yakushev comes away on the right wing, closes in with his shot wide. It bounced in front of the net.
We'd have to come back again.
Still backing up, takes a shot, is right in front of the score! Bill White deflected it into the net. Bill White from, and the score is all tied up. White.
Tretiak played all eight games. Fatigue would take its toll, but not just yet.
Gilbert coming in again. Here's a chance, the shot by Rattel went wide. Gilbert fired one across the goal mouth, and Canada has the zone. The other run here, right in front of the net, a scramble! And Tretiak is down, hanging on for dear life, as they were pouring in on him.
Dryden had his moments, too.
One man back. Here they're closing in. Mihailov shoots, and Dryden came up with a dazzling save. Here's Petrov.
The second period was all Soviet. Their offense, relentless. When Dryden failed, Espo was there.
Over on the far wing, here's a fake shot.
But it was only a matter of time.
Canada carrying the play at this stage. Here's a roll right in front of the net. It's going to be Yakushev. Right in front of the net. And there's that deadly shot again from Sosan to give the Soviet a 4-3 lead. He goes into the corner, knocked down. Stapleton is going to get a penalty.
This time our answer wasn't a goal. Instead, we gave their power play yet another chance and put even more pressure on Ken Dryden.
Back on the board. There's that tic-tac-toe passing play. Vasiliev is going to take a shot. There'll be another penalty on the play. They shoot, they score, Canada!
Down by two, dark thoughts crept in.
I remember thinking to myself absolutely vividly that I could wake up the next morning the most hated person in Canada. Easily. No problem at all. That's what could happen.
Situation critical. Victory remote. But not for Phil.
I thought we were gonna win. And we were walking around. I remember Henderson saying, there's no way they can beat us, guys. And I said, that's right. Let's go out and play our game. We're gonna win. We're gonna win this game. Let's keep our cool. That was the key.
Keep cool when all hell was about to bust loose. Dressing room, an all-pervasive eerie calm. 7 games and 2 periods after it all began, Team Canada confronted defeat, and in so doing, confronted themselves.
I don't think anybody in that room had quit, and it would have been easy for all of them to say, hey, well, we did our best, we came this close, let's just play out the string. But it was obvious there was a degree of anxiety, a feeling of just overwhelming concern, and deathly quiet.
Outside, deafening noise. Additional militia called in. Their need, protect the advantage. Our need, an early goal. And so it came down to 20 minutes. Just 20 more minutes. A time for leaders. A time for heroes. A time for glory.
Peter Mihalovic coming down the right wing, keeps on going into the corner, is bumped back to the net, centered in front. Here's Esposito getting it. Esposito!
The early goal came at 2:27.
All of that is in slow motion. As I speak about it, it's in slow motion. And to me, Peter Mihalov was the spark at that moment that our club needed to come back to win.
Bill has
The desire to win produced the most riveting period of hockey ever. It was all on the line. Close play led to rough play. Rough play to a fight. Fighting was new to the Russians, banned in the international game. But here, things were different. Desperate. Unpredictable. The 10-minute mark, Tretyak and Dryden skated the length of the ice to change ends one last time. Then, with just 7.5 minutes left. An important note, the goal light doesn't go on. That's what started the whole thing. In the crowd, Allan Eagleson noticed the light too, and anger drove him to act, anger that would not be forgotten.
At about the 12-minute mark, just after we've changed ends for the teams, Canada scored, and I noticed the referee signaling the goal, but the goal light hadn't got on. I was probably the only one in the rink who knew the goal judge was Viktor Dombrowski, a Russian referee, who, if he had his chance, I felt would cheat us. I knew I had 3,500 Canadian fans over here who 10 minutes before had been saying, let's go home, when we thought we were being cheated. And I said it wasn't going to happen again. I pushed my way down through the fans here. I got to here and jumped over. In this area, there were literally 200 or 300 Russian militia people who had the good seats, of course. I get down to here, they were wondering what was happening. All I want to do is to get to the timekeeper to tell him to announce the goal.
Mixed up on the far side, the Canadian team are mixing it up with the spectators, and I believe Allan Eagleson is in on it over there as far as we can tell.
Two militia people get me, one around the neck like this, the other with the arm, and start literally dragging me, and then two or three others joined them and started punching me and dragging me to that exit. Suddenly, thank goodness, I look over here, and here comes big Pete Mihaljevic. He reached over, because we're this close to the boards. He hit the one militia man with his stick. He released me. That gave me the chance to push him away, and over from the ice came half the team.
The Canadian team are all over there.
They said, come on, Al, you're coming with us, because the militia men were still looking to get another crack at me. I started to come out here. Now, they've been pushing me around pretty badly, and I remembered I better straighten my tie, and I remember distinctly tucking in my shirt. And I remember my mother, my late mother, telling me she knew I was all right when she saw me tuck in my shirt.
When that rump was started, whatever it was, nobody knows. But Canada tied that score at 12:56, and it appeared to be Cornwallier who got the goal.
Bill Goldsworthy is walking across the ice giving this to the Russian fans. Mike Cannon and the rest are giving them this. I'm shaking my thumb at Dombrowski, and I'm saying, hey, Viktor, up yours. You're not going to cheat us this time. And I was as mad as can be. I then took my place behind the Team Canada bench. There was a little bench or chair sitting there. I remember standing here, and the team shouting myself hoarse, and I was right here cheering when Paul scored the goal.
One last huddle. One last play. And one last Soviet surprise.
The next goal will be the key one. Canadian team went into a huddle there, which seemed to be a little unusual. So they're really fighting. The puck comes up.
A minute left on the clock.
Vasiliev
And the Soviets had sent one of their delegates over to the bench, and he said to me, "We're claiming victory," and the score was tied at that time because we had scored one more goal than you in this series.
1:02 left in the game.
All who watched remember exactly where they were. A hush fell across our land.
I really had a sense that I could score a goal. I started yelling at Peter Mihaljevic to come off the ice, and for some reason, Peter did come off. As Peter came over to the bench, I was looking at the play, of course, and as I jumped over the boards, I saw that Yvonne Cornouaille had the puck at the far boards, and I immediately started yelling Yvonne as hard as I could. The Russian defenseman by this time had come out to reach me, and I fell. As I got up, of course, being aware of the play, I saw that Phil Esposito was going to intercept a pass. And before I even had time to yell at Phil, he just whacked it at Tretiak right here. I got the puck and I tried to immediately shoot it along the ice into the corner of the goal. Tretiak stopped it with his pad. Right back to me, he was down and out, and I had about a foot to put it in. I turned, and Yvonne Cornouaille was there, and I jumped into his arms, gave him a bear hug, and then Big Phil came around, and the three of us were there.
Cornouaille has it on that way. Here's a shot. Henderson made a wild stab for spell. Here's another.
There were still seconds left. Work to be done before the celebration could begin. Seven remarkable days in September, and it was won. The journey, at last, was over.
It is this sense of immense, unbelievable, quiet relief when it's over. It is sitting in your own corner of a dressing room and with a smile on your face. I mean, that's all. And that is the wonderful, wonderful, wonderful moment that stays.
It was going to be easy. It wasn't. It was never supposed to have been this big. It was, and that's what made it so sweet.
I was dressing right near Cornouaille, and I said, "Yvonne, you know," I said, "is this like the Stanley Cup?" He said, "This is 10 times better than the Stanley Cup." So I never had a chance to win the Stanley Cup, but I feel like I've won it 10 times just being a member of Team Canada.
All the endured pain was forgotten now. The absolute effort rewarded. True character surfaced and came to the fore.
They could not come at the same level emotionally than we did, and that's why we won. You cannot play this game without emotion.
From the darkest days, a bond was formed, and it carried them.
We were so close. We were such a team. And sometimes teams, when you become a team, beats all the talent in the world.
Team Canada, our team. We celebrated that late September day, a new sense of pride, of honor, and the knowing of what it truly meant to be Canadian. The Soviet Union, the Iron Curtain, gone now. Old enemies can reflect on the series that opened the door. Petrov, Mikhailov, Henderson, the others, men who were there, men who know what they gave to their game, to their country, to each other, when history was written in the summit on ice.
It will never again be the same as it was in 72. The series with Canada was an historic affair, forever inscribed in the history of the game. It was also critical towards developing hockey throughout Europe and the world.
Almost every day of my life, a Canadian will come up to me and shake my hand and say, you know, thank you for one of the greatest thrills of my life.
I think that series and our team did a lot for Canada. When you have an event that folks who are alive at the time can remember exactly where they were and what they were doing.
Nothing will ever, in my opinion, touch this country coast to coast the way September 28, 72 did.
And when they played that anthem, there was an awful lot of happy people. And I think that's one of the greatest series of all time, who brought all of Canada together, never mind the hockey players. The whole country together.
Because I think this thing really at that time unified the our country, and we probably need that right now. Another Team 72.
Stewart scores, cuts the lead to 14-7. Then, with a score 14-10, Stewart one more time, scores 17-14. Tom Coughlin, he like. Third quarter, though, he wouldn't like this. James Stewart had to leave the game after this Trevor Price tackle with what they called a sprained left foot. Now, don't forget that James Stewart only got the starting gig again because Fred Taylor got hurt. Enter Fred Taylor. With the score tied at 17, fourth quarter, he busts at 38 yards, doesn't see his man late, now he does, wants to slash. Oh, don't slash. That's a fine. 24-17 is now the lead, but late, last 2 minutes, Greasy, in all forms of trouble, finds Byron Chamberlain. What a grab, are you kidding me? And late's in all one motion. 57 yards is the score. Altell is stunned. Greasy finished with 275 yards. That's one stunned Tom Coughlin. But late, Dale Carter gets flagged for pass interference. In the end, it's a 25-yard switch of field position on Jimmy Smith. And with 3 seconds to go, Mike Hollis is good. The Jags win a tight one, 27-24. Jacksonville have now won 10 in a row and are probably the best team in football right now. Meanwhile, each of Denver's last 7 losses have been by 8 points or less.
Battle to escape the Western Conference cellar between the Vancouver Grizzlies and Chris Ford and the LA Clippers. Both teams 4-16 in the season. Derek Anderson off the nice drive on the glass for 2. He had 16. The Clippers in control. The Grizz come back. Bibby to Felipe Lopez. Nice move in the paint. The Grizzlies, though, still down. And by the way, how about the attendance of this one? Yeah, not much. 29-22 LA after 1 in the second. Maurice Taylor, the guy's got some game, folks. That's the Sweet J. Later on, Clippers running the floor nicely. Eric Piakowski off the glass for 2. His only 2 of the game, but LA's still in control. The Clippers too strong in the first half. Maurice Taylor for the J. He misses, but there's the rookie, the sensation, Lamar Odom with the dunk. 2 of his 8, the Clippers up by 9. And look at that. Cherokee Parks, you don't do that. You shouldn't do that in the NBA. The Grizzlies down by 10 in the third quarter. Michael Dickerson around Anderson to the left hand, two of his 21. That cut the lead to 6, but back come the Clippers as they did all night. Anderson the nice look to Michael Olowokandi with the flush. A layup 84-75 after 3. In the fourth quarter, Othella Harrington underneath. Up for 2, no good, but there's Sharif Abdur-Rahim muscling it in. The Grizz cutting into the lead, but too little too late. The Grizz not fouling, down by 8, and it's Michael Olowokandi with the putback, and that would be it. The Clippers win their fifth of the year, 102-90, the final score, snapping a 9-game slide. Big game for Mo Taylor, 26 points and 8 boards, and Michael Olowokandi had a double-double with 16 and 10. The Grizzlies' road woes continue. That's 14 of 15 in the loss column away from home. Ron Tugnutt and the Sens winless in 4 games. They have just 1 win over their last 7. Taking on the Leafs in Toronto in the first period, the Sens on the power play. Sean McEachern out front to Daniel Alfredson. Curtis Joseph there to make the stop. Later on, the Leafs on an odd man rush. Matt Sundin in over the blue line. He feeds Sergei Bereson. What a stop by Tugnutt. That would prove key. No goals through 1 period of play. In the second, early on, 1:17 in, Thomas for Sundin. His shot doesn't reach the net. He gets it back. Jonas Hoglund's shot reaches the back of the net. His 15th, 1-0 Leafs. The Sens looking for one. Look at the work by Magnus Arvidsson on Dmitry Yuskevich. Works him over. Radek Bonk is there to net his 11th of the year. We're all tied at 1 after 40 minutes. Into the third again, Yuskevich is the victim. Andreas Dackel working him over this time. To Sean McEachern, his shot goes in off Caberlet's stick and through Joseph. His 9th made it 2-1. Senators, a little after that, Brian Berard, lead pass to Gary Volk. He came that close to his 3rd goal in 2 games, but he hits the post late in the period. Terrible defense by Toronto. Markov to Bonk, wrong team Danny. His shot is blocked. Marian Hossa will beat Cujo. His 13th makes it a 3-1 game, and that would be it. The Senators finally break a 4-game winless streak for just their 3rd win in 11 games. The Leafs, on the other hand, coming off a 6-goal performance on Saturday night, could only get 1 behind goalie Ron Tugnutt. Ottawa picks up 2 points and are now 5 back of Toronto for top spot in the Northeast Division. Ryan Wilson's Caps not playing very good hockey. Just 1 win in their previous 5 coming into this one. First period, Francis Bouillon mashed into the boards by Jeff Halpin.